In the previous episode, we started with a strategy of translating the words of the title to Sanskrit. Let's continue the same with our next word, religion. The word religion is the central concept of the Gita, but thought to be related to a religion. Let us patiently reveal the hidden mystery around it. We all know that it is the human beings who are divided into various religions. There are many secrets that lie in the simple understanding of the combined two words, human and being. The origin of the word human is from Latin humus, and the word being is a combination of two words, be plus ing. The Indo-European root for be is I or am, and the ing is the form of present continuous tense. The meaning of the word humus is earth, ground, made of five elements of nature, the soil, air, water, fire, and space. And thus, humus is the body. The word for be, I, or am, means self, and the present continuous tense states its presence all times, termed as eternal. The nature of the body is perishable material, called corporeal, and it is visible to the eye. Whereas the nature of eternal self is imperishable, non-material, called incorporeal, and thus invisible. The way a body is addressed is my body. We do not say I am the body. It belongs to me, thus it is separate from me. In case of self, we say I see or I hear. We do not say my eyes see or my ears hear. In Sanskrit, the word for separate or the other is para, and for I or am is called swa or atma in Sanskrit, the self or soul in English. The function of the body is like that of a machine, whereas the function of I or self is energy or the power of thinking and deciding, termed as mind and intellect. Life and death of the human being. Life is when both the humus and the being are together. In Sanskrit, this union of soul with body is called jivan, jivit atma or jivatma, chaitanya atma, dehi, or sharirdhari. The English terms for these words are life, living being or living soul, active soul, personified or embodied or manifested soul. The death is humus minus being. The Sanskrit word for death is dehant, meaning end of the body. Dehatyag means left the body. Dehavas means no more residing in the body. Parthiv sharir or shav means the dead body. In English, we say the gentleman or the lady passed away, which clearly means that the person was the invisible soul who is gone away and is no more residing in the body. Their inactive body is just called the body or the dead body. On death, both the body and the soul are separate, and neither of the two is active, which would logically mean that the soul also perished. Then how can the soul be called imperishable or continuously present or eternal when it is not in union with the body? And if the soul is not in union with the body, soul will be called as I was. It cannot be called being in the sense of present continuous tense, meaning eternally present. So the word being itself means I am. Hence, the soul always has to take a new body. Please note that the Gita mentions humus as deha or indriya, the bodily sense organs, and the being is mentioned as atma, sva, prajna, dhi, all meaning mind and intellect. Some of the supporting Gita verses in the evidence of all the points we mentioned under the practical analysis of the word human being are in chapter 2. Mainly, the numbers are mentioned on the slide. Rebirth of soul is unavoidable process according to the Gita and the study of physics too. The meaning of the word being includes the very process of rebirth. It means I am, it does not mean I was. Thus, soul always takes a body, a new body. Here are the evidences. Gita verse 21 of chapter 2 mentions soul is eternal, free from birth, imperishable, indestructible. Similar to the physics definition, which mentions the energy can neither be created nor destroyed, but only changed from form to another. Gita verse 22 of chapter 2 mentions that just like a human being leaves his old clothes and takes on the other new clothes, similarly the soul leaves the old bodies and keeps on taking other new bodies. Gita verse 27 of chapter 2 mentions death of one who is born is certain and birth of the one who dies is also certain. It is unavoidable. The law of physics mentions energy is the capacity for doing work. There are moreover heat and work, that is energy in the process of transfer from one body to another. Soul is energy or light. The evidence is that in physics as well as nature, light is energy and energy is light. The sun is the main source of energy. Similarly, Gita also mentions soul to be light. The Sanskrit word is jyoti, used in Gita verses 24 of chapter 5, 24 of chapter 8, 21 of chapter 10 and 17 of chapter 13. In physics, light is not visible to the naked eye, but can be seen through prism dispersion. Gita verse 18 of chapter 2 mentions aprameyasya, which means devoid of visible proof. Gita verse 9 of chapter 8 mentions soul to be aniyamsam anoha, which means subtler than a subtle atom. Soul cannot be seen with any device. Hence the soul or self may be said to be a subtler than subtle point of light. The definition of soul in the other three major religions that matches with that of Gita, Islam, Buddhism, Christian religion mention about soul as the Hebrew Bible reference mentions concept of spirit, describing it as a part of mankind that is immaterial, like one's mind, emotions, will, intellect, personality, and conscience. Another verse from Bible by Matthew mentions, do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Islam mentions soul as a person's immortal, essential self. Buddhist, though they believe in anatman, meaning no soul or self, but they call it avachya, inexpressible self, or vijnana, which is consciousness, which is same as mind and intellect. Thus, we can see that Islam, Christianity, and Buddhism also mention the soul as the self. Rebirth of soul is unavoidable, but accepted by none. The rebirth of imperishable soul is unavoidable according to the meaning of the word being, the Gita, and the study of physics too. Yet, the four religions differ. The Hindu gurus speak of nirvana, which is freedom from rebirth. Buddhist followers believe in nirvana, which means one can achieve freedom from rebirth. Islam and Christians believe that there is only one bodily birth and that their imperishable soul is judged at the end of the world on judgment day regarding their deeds in that one birth. Only one bodily birth, no rebirth. In fact, all of us want long and happy life for one another. Then why would one want to be free from rebirth rather than being free from sorrows? The Gita is about becoming free from sorrows, not rebirth. The Sanskrit word for religion is dharma. Gita talks about dharma, adharma, swadharma, and paradharma. And from the meaning of the word human being, we understood that human or humus is para, the other, and the being is self, the swa. Now let's look at the meaning of the word dharma in Sanskrit. Dharma is manner, nature, attribute or virtues, law or justice personified, character, righteousness. In a single word, dharma or religion may be said to be righteousness or wealth of virtues. Now the next word, adharma, in Sanskrit means immoral, not pious, guilt, sin, injustice, unrighteousness, irreligion, wickedness, and demerit. Thus, adharma may be said to be unrighteousness or irreligion, whether it is the righteous qualities or the unrighteous wicked qualities. Both are in the being part, not the humus part. It is the being, the self, the mind and intellect that either enjoys through its virtues or suffers through its wicked qualities. Gita verse 35 of chapter 3 mentions Swadharma Shreyaha, Paradharma Bhayavaha. Shreyaha means beneficial, Bhayavaha means terrifying. Hence, Swadharma would be when the self, point of light, sees all as point of light, identical to itself. Then it is righteousness or dharma. In other words, it would be oneness, logically said to be soul conscious or self-realized. In Sanskrit, it is called Atmavan, as mentioned in Shloka 45 of chapter 2, which would be high will or soul power, because you're not drained of unnecessary thoughts, thinking of differences of opinions among each other. Whereas Paradharma is when the self sees itself as body, para, then its identities are varying with others, like its worldly religion, caste, creed, customs, color, race, statutes, manners, law and ordinances. Additionally, in the modern world, we have status, education, position, etc. All bodily identities are infinitely divided, thus are unrighteous, irreligious, or called as adharma. Logical term would be body conscious, that drains will or soul power. Swadharma is when the soul is completely independent of the body and enjoys the life like a king and rules over the body. Whereas in Paradharma, the soul, the self, is a slave to body. How terrifying or bhayavaha is the level of body consciousness in the world today? The answer is in the name of the current aeon, Kali Yuga or Kalaha Yuga, which means contention, dispute, quarrel, beating, deceit, kicking, fight, falsehood, contending, strife, abuse, violence without murderous weapons, worst of a class or number of objects, discord. The condition of human soul and the world is very frightening today, classified as worst of a class. Soul is compared to iron that rusts, hence aptly called the Iron Age. The class or varna, the color of the soul, is black, like iron rusted completely. The color of soul, which in Sanskrit is varna, is called shudra or kshudra, meaning small, cruel, low, worthless, mean-hearted, beggarly. Hence, today the entire world of all humans are of shudra class. In this chapter, we covered the Sanskrit word religion. Let's have a recap. The soul is said to be eternal because rebirth is an unavoidable process. The Sanskrit meanings of the words dharma, adharma, swadharma and paradharma are covered. Dharma is only one pertaining to the soul, self or swa, called swadharma. And adharma are many, such as Hindu, Islam, Buddhism, Christianity and others, full of falsehood, are called paradharma. Today, if we were to ask anyone, what are the list of qualities of righteousness or unrighteousness, each person from every religion would come up with his own definition. So let us look at the list of the qualities of righteousness and unrighteousness as mentioned in the Gita.
We request the viewers to watch the three series and the episodes within the series in the numbered sequence. We have used questioning technique where each and every point is questioned, answered in the most practical manner, supported by religious scriptural references and other authentic evidences, and thus are arranged in logically meaningful flow.